Okay, so my port number 9, which is ISE, should be in VLAN 150. The other one, 10, 10, 10. So everything seems okay from this side. R1, I have two EIGRP neighbors, all is good. I should be able to ping whom? ISE. R1 should be able to ping ISE, R1 should be able to ping 30.3, 20.2, all good. Right? Looking at the topology, this is what we are doing. This guy right here is trying to ping, he's able to ping this end, this whole thing, and this end. So R1 has connectivity to all of them. Plus R1 is also a DHCP server. It's also a DHCP server. So that's another added point we have here. He'll be giving out addresses to people who log in. Now, the job right now is switch one. Is going to be what? A client of ISE. Let's do that first. Let's do that first. First, I want to check what switch one's SVI is. Good. And switch two should be 16. There you go. 15 and 16. That's great. Right? So one end should be able to go to another. That means my trunks are working fine. Now the problem is IAC right now is completely blank. It's not a problem. It's just that it's black and we need to bring it up. HTTPS. Right. First thing that we are going to be doing is set up the relationship between ISE and switch one. Later, if we need, we'll set it up with switch two. Why am I putting it up with switch one? Because my test PC. Okay, I also need to draw another topology. This is very important. The physical. This is all I need. Then I have the box. This is IAC right here. What about my physical test PC that I'm going to be connecting? My physical test PC, which is this guy. Right? Let's label these up. IAC. This is test PC. Where is this test PC connected? Physically, these are the connections physically. R1, R2, R3, ISC, then you have test PC. Connected to the other side, to the rack, the one which I'm consoling into right now, and again R1 is here, R2 is here, R3 is here. You know this is 00, 01 for both of them. This is 1, 2, 3, ISE is on 9, test PC is 21. This PC is 21. This is 1, 2, 3. We are going to have to find a way. We're going to have to find a way to make sure that this physical and this logical right here match. This one and this one right here. So what I'll do is let's snip this up. Save it. right? So I have to match this and this. Move this, this and this. Now think about it. Who's going to be my client? This is switch one, switch two. Remember my job yesterday? My job was logically, I have to move this guy, but physically you'll always be connected to one place. Physically the guy will always be connected here. But logically, I'm going to have to move him here sometimes. Sometimes he'll come into sales, sometimes he'll come into marketing, sometimes he comes into IT, different departments. Same physical guy, I'll be connected to the same port. It's just that logically my VLANs will change in a way so that they move me from one place to another, from another to another. My client right now is going to be whom? ICE. Who's the client of ICE going to be? Switch one. It's going to be switch one. Why? Because TestPC is trying to come into switch one. TestPC is trying to come into switch one. Switch one is not allowing him to come in. So whatever use, he's asking for him for a username and password. That username and password TestPC replies back to the switch. The switch relays it on to whom? Between TestPC and switch, what is the communication? What takes place? EAPOL. And then from switch to ICE? ICE tells whom? The switch. Tells the switch, okay, allow him to come in. Then he's allowed. Also, see, first he'll just only allow him to come in. You have some additional features where he can tell him, put him into this VLAN, give him this ACL. That is called authorization. We'll have a look at that also later. Right now what we are doing is authentication, pure authentication. Allowed access or not allowed access? Allowed or not allowed, right? So what is the first thing that we have to do? Set up this relationship. Between whom? ICE and switch. Using radius. Clear? Let's do that. Do I have the commands from yesterday? No. Radius server. AAA. AAA new model, radius server host, who's the host? 151.7.20, authentication port is, accounting port is, and key, Cisco. That's all, nothing special, so all I do, go back to ISC, all I need to do is administration. Network devices. In my network devices, I'll add another device, the new one. This one will be called switch one. Authentication settings will be radius. Password will be Cisco. This thing still has not come yet, the IP part. So we'll probably go back. The ports, if you don't, since it's an old switch, if you don't, it will go back to using 1645, which is okay. ICE responds to both, but it's better to use the new one because it has new features. Not 2015. Switch 1 is going to be my client. And then the password that I said, shared secret, was Cisco, submit. How do you test the relationship? Test AAA, which group?
Radius.
Username and password, anything. Any username, any password. And which method? User was rejected by the server, which is good news. Rejection is good. That means he exists. It's established between the switch and ISP. Now, What I want you to see, this is a good troubleshooting step in ICE. Always, always check your operations and always do that. Because you'll exactly know what is happening right now. It tells you the log, it tells you the message, it tells you what's wrong, why is it working, why is it not working. Right now, switch one is coming to ISC. Right now, you see, if you move your mouse over this, shows you authentication fail. He shows you the username the guy came in with. Even the username the guy came in with. It's a good, very good troubleshooting step. Right now it looks small, but later you'll see how good, how powerful this is. Because you know everything that is happening. You know exactly, if the username is not coming, you know the relationship is not there. If you don't see anything here, means the switch's packet is not reaching here. And stuff like that. Very important.
Kind of.
New code? No, that works the same way. It's just that the messages that it shows you are a little different. It's hard, isn't it?
Here
is
also the same
way. Here, see, if I use new code, you will not see a difference. It's just the way it displays it on the switch. User rejected. But here, it'll be the same. It's just that way it displays it on the switch, the code. It's nothing different. Okay? It's not, you can't call this accounting. You can't call this. This is ICE keeping record of itself. Accounting works on a separate port, 1813. This is not accounting. You cannot call this accounting. This is ICE keeping tabs of what is actually happening. Whatever packets are coming into IEC, he's opening them up and showing it to you that I've received this, I've received this, I've received this username, this password at this time. Accounting is something else. Accounting is, he'll monitor each and everything that the user is doing on the switch. And then keep a track of that. This is different. Clear? Now, the relationship is set up. I need to create an identity group. An identity group. For whom?
For
people who are going to come in, right? Now, you'll have to understand the theory behind this. I only have in my company one PC. It's a poor company, only one PC. But with that one PC, I give a lot of people access to whatever they want. So salespeople are going to be coming in and sitting on this. Marketing people are going to be coming in and sitting on this. IT people are going to be coming in, sitting on the same PC. Yeah? Yeah, but I'll have to make sure that will he be allowed access or not. The first is the most basic one that we are going to be doing. Based on username and password, is he allowed access or is he not allowed access? That's it. So I'll create three groups first. Let's keep them created. Sales. I'll add another one, Mark, which is marketing. IT will be the third one. Sales, marketing, and IT. Then users I need to create, which I'll put into the different groups. So let's say sales one. Password, Cisco 123 with a C capital. Cisco 123, and which group does he belong to? Belongs to sales. Create another one. Mark one, password same. Cisco 123. Where does he belong? Mark. Finally, IT1. Cisco 123, and IT. That's all I did. Created three users. So now, if you try from here, all of three should be what? Sales one. Successfully authenticated. Mark 1 successfully authenticated, and IT 1 should also be authenticated. All three users are there available with ICE, and you can, if they try to log in here, they should be able to have access to it. The question though is, I want to do stuff to which port? port number 21 on the switch. Right? I want to enable authentication on that port. I want to make sure whoever logs in, by default, everybody is allowed access. Have you ever seen any switch blocking you? Whenever you buy a new switch, you plug in your PC, it starts working. With Cisco, with all, with anything. Right? It's authorized. It's full authorized. I don't want to do that. I don't want to have access. I don't want on port 21. I don't want to give anybody full access. I want to block it. See, I'll show you. There's two. Which port it is? Interface FA021. We call this authentication. AAA new model is online. First things first, show run. Let me show you something. 21 is empty. Interface 21 is empty. What is this thing called where you control your port? You know what this is called? You control your port and then users will log in, they will put in their username and password and then that will be checked against the RADIUS server. What is this protocol called? Not protocol, there's a whole, the whole system is given a name. Dot 1x is a way where there's two ways, wired and wireless. Dot 1x is a way where your PC is automatically authenticated only if you provide the real username and password which is there on ICE or on AD or on any other device. Right? Two things we are going to be doing. Dot 1x, the other one is called MAB, MAC address bypass. We'll see that later. Right now what we are doing is concentrating on dot 1x. Now first things first, I want to do dot 1x on which port? 21. I don't want it to be authorized. I want it to be in automatic condition. I want my port 21 to be in automatic, which means the user comes in. This will be dynamic. He will ask him for a username. The port will ask for a username and password. The guy will reply with the username and password using EAP and then the whole RADIUS system will work. For this to work, the first thing you do is you enable dot 1x globally. You enable it globally by using the command dot 1x system auth control. dot 1x will control the system authentication of the ports which I tell him to. You are enabling it globally. Let me do this on notepad. dot 1x interface FA021, not interface. First step is enable dot 1x. This has to be there. This right now it's not enabled on all the ports. It's, do you know how DHCP snooping, what do we do in DHCP snooping? There's two things. First we say IP DHCP snooping, then we say IP DHCP snooping VLAN 150, right? So it doesn't work in all the VLANs, it only works in VLAN 150. That's the same thing here. I say dot 1x system auth control, I'm turning the feature on. But then I need to go to that port and tell them, okay, this port will be controlled by dot 1x. First global, the feature has to be turned on, then I'll go to each port whichever I want to use dot 1x on, and then on that port I will say, I'll tell you what the command is. First dot 1x system auth control. So enable dot 1x global. Okay. I made a slight mistake with the topology. It's gone. Let's draw switch one. Have the physical with you too. Because it's all about physical to logical. This is ISC. And this right here is the test PC we care about. Right? And 1, 2, 3, 9, 21. So out of these ports, which port am I concerned about? This one right here. This one right here. I don't care about the rest of the ports because already they are connected, they are authorized, they are using the network, everything is well and good. I only care about port 21 because that is the one where the test PC will be connected. Now to this port 21, I want to enable what? .1x. Before you enable .1x or anything like that, the first criteria is it has to be an access port. It has to be in a VLAN. The first criteria is that it has to be access. It has to be in a VLAN. Because obviously you will not do this on a trunk. Right? So preventing you from doing that. Plus it has to be in a VLAN because it needs connectivity after that. It needs connectivity on layer 3. So you put it in a VLAN. The commands will not work. See, I'll show you. So check interface FA021. The command is called authentication port control auto. Authentication port control auto means this port will be controlled by .1x. But the command is not here. You can't use it unless I do this. Authentication port control right has to be an access, otherwise it will not even read. Right? I will not put it in a VLAN. I want to show you the consequences of that when I don't put it in a VLAN. The moment I do this, this port, if you check this, there's 3. There's an auto, authentication port control auto. There's force authorized, force unauthorized. Can you tell me the difference between force authorized and force unauthorized?
Authorized means it cannot have access.
If you connect it, it will have access, or if it, it will not have access. But if you remember, by default, it's what?
It's authorized.
It has access. You can either turn the access down, say on this port, no one will have access, or you can say everybody will have access, or you can say it should be automatic. Automatically means what? .1x. But for this .1x to work, globally that command should be on. Right? The moment I do this, auto, .1x gets enabled on this port, on port 21. It gets enabled. But there's a problem. Remember yesterday, username and password, and I wanted to check with the login. I pointed my login lines towards what? The AAA server. I said AAA login default, point them group to the radio server. How do I do it with .1x? .1x is not login into the switch. I'm not logging in into the switch, so it's not AAA login. It's not AAA authentication login. I need to point somewhere and tell the switch that whoever is trying to .1x into you, you check that .1x against whom? The AAA server. Let's check. AAA authentication whoever tries to .1x and whatever username and password he provides with his EAPOL frames, I want you to, now you can create a list or you can do it default. Here there is no problem with default because there is no 3 lines or 4 lines, there is just one line which is .1x. So you can say default, point it where? Group radius. I'm going to point it to my group, which is the radius. Okay? You also have to understand something about .1x. when you're doing dot 1x, I have it. When you're doing dot 1x, there's three things which are important. You know what those things are? You should have done it in AAA. In dot 1x, there's three things. There is a switch. There is the AAA. And then there is the PC. You know the technical terms for these devices?
Supplicate.
Who's the supplicate?
The PC.
This is called the supplicant. He supplies with the username and password. This guy is known as authentication. And this is called authenticator. Switch one is called the authenticator. The supplicant goes to the authentication server through the authenticator. Whenever you're using .1x on a port, whenever you're doing that, you need to make sure that on that port, you tell the switch that this, you are an authenticator. What was the commands we did until now? Let's close this. I enabled .1x globally. Then I went into my interface. Also, I did something else globally, which is AAA authentication .1x. Default group. Then I went under my FA021 and I said first switch port mode access and authentication port control. Two things I said: switch port mode access, authentication port control. Also one last command that I need to put is called .1x PAE, telling this port you're going to be an authenticator. Why does he need to know that? Because he needs to be able to convert EAPOL from frames into radius frames. For that, the port should know that he's the authenticator. That is the job of the authenticator. When he receives that EAPOL frame, he needs to make sure that he can convert it into the radius one. He acts like a bridge in the middle. But for that, the port should know he is the authenticator. Okay? So .1x PAE authenticator. That's all.
All the switch support .1x feature. All the switch support .1x feature.
No. Not all. Based on what iOS you're using, different if you same switch, use a different iOS. It will not support .1x.
Okay.
Depends on the iOS that you're using. Obviously, it should be a layer 3 switch, a good layer 3 switch. 3550 and above. Not the lower ones, which are not used anymore. But a good switch between this range, this or above.
2960
also supports, but it works perfectly with these switches. But again, the iOS matters much more than the device. The iOS is correct, it supports.
iOS security.
Security. Advanced security. Okay? I have not specified any. Right now, I'm only going to do authentication. When we do authorization, the VLAN is going to be supplied by the ISE. But that's not what I'm going to do. It has to be an access port because for the VLAN assignment, first, the other thing is it's a port control auto, right? If it's a port control auto, you cannot do it with trunks. Because trunks on the other end of trunks are what? Switches, right? So switch and switch There's no need to authorize or unauthorize. It's like you just connect it. It's not a supplicant on the other side. For you to be a supplicant, you have to be an access point. You understand this command? .1xpae authenticator? Port should know that he is the authenticator. Right? Now someone... Auto? Auto means .1x. Authenticate this port using .1x. Port controller. By default it's authorized. Everybody is allowed. But you tell him, I don't want it authorized or unauthorized. It should be automatic. You should ask for a username and password. Check that against the radio server. Get it back. If the radio server says accept, then accept it and let him come in. Define policies on ISP. Right now, I'll show you how to do that. What I would like to do is 421. We need it for the video, otherwise you'd have just done it there. Oh, can't use it. Using wireless, I can't use it. We tried with your PC. Before it's flapping. So try this. Make it. You connect the PC to say port 21. The moment you connect that PC to that port, see what's going to happen. You also have to do certain stuff. I'll show you that here. When you connect on Microsoft, by default, authentication is off. .1x authentication is off. On your Android phones, you have the ability to turn it on very easily. Just turn on .1x. Submit your username and password, starts working. But on Microsoft, it's off by default. Why? Because you just connect and it's authorized. Right? You need to turn it on. How? You go to your services. Stephen, you following?
Yes.
Go to your services. In the services, you have this one service known as Wired Autoconfig. Wired Autoconfig turns your .1x on. Check this out right now. There's only two tabs, right? Networking and sharing. But when I go in here and I say for example start, the moment you say start, you have another field called what? .1x, IEEE 802.1x authentication. It's a set of protocols defined under 802.1.x. Right? So what you do is you enable it. The one which you're using, you have certain versions of it. The one by default is PEAP. If you're going to use the different ones, you'll have to make changes on ISC and so for it to support those different ones. I'll show you a way to do that. Okay, then you go to settings. Validate server certificate. What does that mean? It means whatever certificate ISE is sending you, first validate it. Then let access. But I'm not going to validate because I know that I'm not signed it by any CA, so I'm not going to validate anything. Just gonna keep it on. Then, what do you want to use? A smart card or certificate? Or you just want to use a secure password? I'm obviously going to use a secure username and password. Second one is if you have a certificate to authenticate. CA certificate from your end. So you give out the certificate. The ISE will check your certificate and make sure that you're allowed on.
No need of
username. But then you'll have to configure that certificate. Usually what happens is, what you usually do is, you have a server, for example, Microsoft AD or with Microsoft AD, another Microsoft server. So what that CA server does is, it gives out certificate. You come in, you say, I want a connection. They give a certificate on your name. You go in and you install it on your PC. Next time when you connect, they don't ask you for a username and password. The certificate goes automatically. They know it's you. So, it's a protected certificate, can only be installed on your PC. Okay, so you can configure it. Do not check this button. Automatically verify my Windows login name and password. Do not use that. Because you're not going to use your Windows username and password. What are you going to use? You're going to use sales one and whatever sales password is. Okay, so keep it exactly as it is. Press OK and OK. Should not have done that. You guys, Steven, you do OK. Keep it as it is. What is going to happen is, you'll get a pop-up asking you for a username and password. Enable .connect. Step it on. Turn off all the features. Attempting to authenticate. Now, how you check it is, show authentication. Show authentication sessions. Yeah, that's fine. I'll tell you what to do. Show authentication sessions shows you this switch. Who is he trying to authenticate with? What is he trying to do? Which authentications are happening? What kind of authentications are happening and some other stuff. Okay, right now he says no Auth Manager exists. That's because for this to work, you'll have to put the port in a specific VLAN. You'll have to put the port in a specific VLAN. That is exactly when it can go and ask for a username and password. That is a prerequisite. I didn't put him in any VLAN, right? You don't put him in any VLAN, he cannot go to the supplicant and ask for a... He needs to put him into a certain VLAN first. Know that he's in that VLAN. Then the Auth Manager runs. If he doesn't know he's he doesn't know which VLAN does he belong to, he doesn't know where to put that port in. Right? So, you need to say switch port, access, VLAN. I'll put him into 150 first. 150 is which one? This one. I'm connecting him. Logically, I'm connecting him where? Yeah. So, either he'll be authorized or he'll be unauthorized. If he's authorized, if he protects, if he puts in the real username and password, what is going to happen? He's going to send out what? A DHCP. Discover to get an IP, and who is going to receive that IP? Discover R1 will reply with a address and give it to him. If I had not put him into any VLAN, what was he gonna do? Where was he gonna go? Nowhere. Just disable, see if disable and enable that port again. Clear authentication failed. Have you unchecked the username and this?
Right click on that one. Authentication. Enable. Settle. Verify service. This should be off. This should be off. Enable. Should be off. Configure. Yeah. No, not okay. Now disable them and enable them. This one the way you can make it. No, I need to support again. No, it doesn't have anything to do with Windows Firewall. Get a pop-up. No. Authentication is .winx default. With the Windows 8, right? Remember. .winx in system auth control is on. It's fine, I just have to do this. I didn't use one command. Which command did I not use? I wrote it on the notepad. .winx. That was why. The switch did not know that he's an authenticator. He doesn't know if he's an authenticator, doesn't know what to do with it. Right? Try now. Disable and enable it again. Now it should work. Down, come up, there you go. Starting .winx, authentication failed for client. Authentication result was fail. Did you get the pop-up? It says authentication failed because probably you have a username and password saved somewhere. Wait. Now try disable enable again. First time it fails automatically. The moment you get these messages, means the relationship is set up, he's receiving .winx frames, and he's trying to go to ISC. Means he became the authenticator. Right? My auth manager, this is known as auth manager. Got it? Now put in your sales one, and the password, C capital Cisco 123. See, now you have started .winx. The moment username and password is entered, C caps, 123. Authentication, successful. Authentication is successful. The moment authentication is successful, check this out, what happens. This guy came in, his authentication was successful, which means first he put in sales, one, the username he put was sales. Password he put in was Cisco 12. This information reached whom? No, the IAC. Reached the IAC and the IAC said access, accept or reject. You might have been able to see it on Wireshark. Access, accept should be the last command. Right? What you can do is you can actually go to IAC. That's why I wanted you to see this before. Check this out. See, first, is your PC's name CCI Security?
Yes.
So first he used his Windows login name and to come in. So you know the Windows login name was coming up. The MAC address of the device was this. And that's why he failed the authentication the first time. Next time when he tried, they asked him for the username and password. He put in sales and the password. He doesn't show the password, obviously, here. Doesn't show the password here. MAC address right here. Right? Then, he was allowed access. Identity group that he belongs to. The user is sales, but the group that he belongs to is, username is sales one. Posture is something we will do later, and authentication was successful. So he allowed him access. Right now, what do you think will be the IP address of this test PC? 150.1.7. Somewhere around after 100. Remember, we have excluded from 1 to 100 on the DHCP server. So what is your IP?
102.
The IP that he has received is 102. If you want to check it from here, ping 150.17.102. See what? ICE doesn't know that. ICE works on layer 2. All ICE has to do is allow the switch permission. That's all. He'll get a username and password. He'll tell the switch access accept, access reject. After that, ICE's job is over. After that, it's all here. After that, what? He's allowed access. That's it. He's allowed access into the network. Then whatever are the network permissions, whatever they do, it works the exact same way. R1 is the DHCP server. He gives out the DHCP address to him. He gets access. He gets the address. From that address, he can ping and communicate to all of them. Right now, he should be able to open ICE on his PC. Because he's here, right?
Yes.
If he goes to 151.7.20, should be able to open ICE. Should be able to ping R1, R2, R3, this, the whole network, he's a part of it. But from this end. Okay. Which is dangerous because I'm giving sales guy access to full network. He has full authorization to do anything that he wants, which is not safe. So can you open it? See the page, ISE page. Certificate, yeah, just accept the certificate and then he'll get the page. Right?
Yes.
Now he has, you can also ping R1, R2. R2 is this interface, R3 is this, because the EIGRP and everything is running, so you have full ping capability. Is this part clear? Clear? This is .1x. Simple .1x. Username and password, the ICE says access accept, he's accepted, he gives permission. Now whichever VLAN you put him into, obviously he'll be put there. I put him into 150, so he was put on this segment, and then his username and password went. He was applied, allowed, DHCP request was sent, and everything was.
But the user can access ICE also.
Yeah, that's the thing, that's why we authorize it. This is just authentication. Based on username and password, he's authenticated and allowed access. Next thing that we'll do is authorization. Authorize him not to use the whole thing. Okay? We'll do that after the break. I wanted to show you this. Right now, we didn't do anything. We just had identities here, network devices, and that's all we did. The guy got authenticated, he got access to the network. Remember on Windows, I showed you PEAP. If you're using PEAP, then you have to. By default, you use PEAP. Where do you choose those things? Policy. You have policy. Authentication policies. Right? If you click on authentication policies and you refresh the page first, because it's probably timed out.
With admin, you can have multi-session on ICE. With the user admin, you can have multi-session on ICE.
You can have what on the ICE?
Session. To access, if I use, for example, you have only one admin for the access.
For account, access, yeah.
You can have multi-session, multi-user
Yeah.
Admin.
Yeah. Yeah. With admin, different sessions. You can have that. Yeah. There you go. What I want you to see is, by default, two protocols are allowed on ICE. .next and MAB. .next we are doing right now. MAB, I'll show you how to do. But which kind of .next is allowed?
Wired
.next, not wireless. Wireless, I'll show you when you do it. Right? So by default, these two are allowed. If you're doing wireless, you'll have to add that here. This is rules, authentication rules. There's two things. Authentication rules, which is here. These are authentication rules and authorization rules. Then these are results. Authentication results, authorization results. The protocols which are allowed are under this authentication results protocols. By default, everything goes through default network access. But we want to see what default network access is. Default access covers all of these protocols. You have PAP, you have EAP MD5, you have MS CHAP V2, V1, you have TLS, PEAP, remember? We use PEAP. That's a good drink now. PAP on Windows, right? You have EAP FAST, another version of it, of EAP. All of them come with different features. EAP GTC, this is certificate-based EAP. Then you have MS CHAP V2, which we just used. And you have TLS again. You have PAC and certain chaining. Chaining is when you use two together, MAC address and .next both together. Both should work, which is called EAP chaining. Right? I'm just showing you this because, see, by default, everything is enabled, the one which you need. But tomorrow, maybe, they'll ask you to use EAP FAST or a variant of EAP FAST. Where will you allow it? You'll come in here, ticket. Where? Policy, results, authentication. Authentication results, obviously, because you're using this for authentication and allowed protocols. Okay? Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that you use this default network access. I can create another one. I'll call it PAP. Say for example, I'll only allow what? I'll only allow PAP on this one. Where do I bind it? Where do you think I can bind it? In the rules, which is authentication rules. See, by default, both of them are using what? Default network access. If I change this to PAP, they will not be able to support MSCHAP, MSCHAP V2, EAP and all of the other stuff. Why would you need this? Why would you do something like this? Tomorrow maybe you have some other way of authentication. Maybe you want to check line VTY. And for that only PAP is used. So for them you will bind it with what? You will not use default access, you will use PAP. Clear?
You can apply multiple elements on the rule.
In the rules? This rule?
This rule.
In one rule, only one element, one protocol, one result.
You're not buying
those. See what this means? This means if the guy is coming using wired MAP, he should be allowed only these protocols. If he's coming using wired.next, he should be allowed only these protocols. Tomorrow you may have something else coming in. At that time, you'll create that here. So if he's coming using Telnet, allow him only PAP, because he doesn't need MSCHAP or MSCHAP V2 or PAP, PAP or anything like that. Only all he requires is PAP. So you can add that here. Clear? Clear, everybody? Now, that is this. This is authentication rules. The other rules that you have is authorization. Authorization rules. What do I want to do to the guy who's coming? First things I'll do is VLAN assignment. First part that we're going to be covering is VLAN. Based on sales, If he's a sales guy, I'll put him into VLAN 10. If he's a marketing guy, I'll put him into VLAN 20. If he's an IT guy, I'll put him into VLAN 30. What do I mean by that? What I mean is this. If he's sales, he should come here in this subnet. If he's marketing, he should come in this subnet. If he's IT, he should come in this subnet. Why would I do something like that? Maybe because my sales servers are somewhere here. So he has direct access to the sales server. Right? My marketing, my IT servers are here. He has full access to the IT server. And this is for sales. He needs access to these routers and everything. So I'll put the sales guy here. That's VLAN assignment. But I need to do something on ISE to make sure that VLAN is pushed down to the switch. How do I do that? Again, the concept is the same. Results are here, rules are here. But which results do I care about now? Not authentication results, but authorization results. Authorization results. There's something known as authorization profile. Authorization profile. You create a profile. Let's do that. It'll be more easier when I create it. You create a profile. There's some already there. I don't care about those some. I'll create a new one. This one, I will name it as sales result. If it's a sale guy, the result for sales. I have a lot of options here. The only one thing that I'm going to do is to the sales guy, put him into VLAN. Which VLAN? Sales should go into VLAN. That's all I'll do. Nothing special. Then I'll create another result. Okay, saved already. Sales is already there. I can create another result. This is mark result. I'm gonna put him into 20. Submit. You can add descriptions here. I didn't add descriptions. Descriptions can be added here. This one. Okay. The last one is IT underscore result. And the VLAN that I'm going to be putting him into is 30. Done. I've created three results. IT sales and marketing. I need to bind it. Where do I bind it? I need to create a rule. Just like authentication has a rule, authorization should also have a rule. So I'll go here. Authorization rule. There are a few already. For IP phones, it's automatic. IP phones are automatically authorized to use voice VLAN. I'll show you what that is when we move to IP phones. For now, I'll have to create a rule. How do you do this? You click here, insert a new rule, above. This name of the rule has no significance at all. You can have anything. This is just the name of the rule. But what I'll have is sales. I'll call it sales rule. This is group. Which group should the guy belong to? User identity or endpoint identity? User identity. But which one?
Sales.
Basically, I'm saying is, if the guy belongs to the group sales and he's coming in, there's either you create a new condition, which is an advanced thing, which you don't do. You learn it later. You select a condition from the library. But these conditions are not simple. They are compound. What are these compound conditions? Wired.1x, wired map, wireless.1x, wireless map. If you leave this open, blank, you don't configure this, it will still work, but this is being more specific. That the guy is going to come in, if he belongs to sale, and he's coming in using what? Wired.1x. If he belongs to sales, and he's coming in using wired.1x, I want you to give him which result? Standard. Not these, standard. Which result should be given to him?
Sales
result. Which means VLAN
10 should be given to him. What I'm saying is if a guy comes in who belongs to the group sales and he's coming in using wire.onyx, give him sales results. Okay? I did it for sales, I'll do it for others also. I'll duplicate it above so that I just have to change certain options. Same for marketing. If he's coming in using marketing, wire.onyx is the same. Which result to give him? Marketing result. This will be marketing. Right? This is just VLAN assignment. I'm still not helping, I'm still not controlling him.
Okay.
I'm just giving him an access list. This will be IT. If he's coming in using, if the username that he comes in is IT, y.1x, give him the result IT. What is IT result? IT result only says one thing, that VLAN 30 should be given. That's the only thing that IT result says. Okay? Where do I create these results? In authorization profiles. Here? In authorization profiles. Where did I get this from? It's a compound condition already created. Where did I get this group from? I created it earlier in groups and identities. R3? No. I'll show you what it does. See, I'll go back to my switch. Now the only problem is authentication will pass for me. But the switch, see, only thing I told him is authentication.1x should be done based on radius. I didn't tell him anything about authorization. Right? Do your this again. I'll clear authentication sessions here. He will shut it down and bring it back up again. His interface. And he'll save in his, put in his username and password. Wait, let me do this for your port. Interface F821, switch port, port fast. No, not port secure. Spanning tree port fast. Come up quickly now. Otherwise, when he turns it off, brings it back again, it goes through the spanning tree process. Takes time. Done? Put in your username whenever he asks you for it. And now it's down. What's up? There you go, starting.1x. You don't want to?
He's still asleep. He don't want to wake up.
He doesn't want to wake up. What, your laptop?
Yeah.
Your laptop is sleeping.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay. You have another one?
Yes.
Enable.onyx first. Disable all the other features. Fast connect, eat connect, everything else.
Stephen Kaleva.
No, not remember credentials. Not fallback. Settings. Not fast reconnect.
And
no, it's okay. Yes, Stephen.
Okay.
starting node is username sales 1, password Cisco 123 with a C capital. Sales 1, password is sys0123, cisco123, with the C capital. Done. Authentication successful. Authorization succeeded. But nothing else happened. Nothing else happened. If you check the VLAN of this guy, show VLAN brief, you'll see that port number 21 is still in which VLAN? Why nothing happened? Because the switch is not listen. He doesn't care about authorization right now. He's only going to the ISE for authentication. So he authenticates and gets everything all right. For him to go to ISE for authorization, what do you use? AAA authorization. This, the one which you've used before, is called exec. Use this before. Exec was used for what? Exec authorization. Means shell profile and all of those things. Privilege level. This is not privilege level authorization. This is network authorization. You'll be putting him into a different VLAN. You'll be changing his networks from one place to another. So this authorization is what? Network authorization. AAA authorization network, and which one? Obviously, you'll do default because you want to do it for all. And point him where? To the group. Clear auth sessions. Do the same thing. Shut, no shut. That's fine. Don't do anything. The username and password are saved. Look at what happened. Starting .1x. Authentication result is success. Authorization result is success. VLAN 10 has been assigned to port 21. VLAN 10 has been assigned. Yeah. Before that, it was in the same VLAN which I had put him into. Check this out. Show run interface FA021. Under the interface, what is the VLAN? But if you check show VLAN brief, where? In VLAN? From here, now think about this. I've assigned him which VLAN? VLAN. Right now, I've assigned him VLAN 10. So he has come where? His DHCP will come in from this interface. So which address do you think he'll be given now? 1.10. He'll be given an address from this range. Right? Earlier, I had not authorized him. It was connected here. It was in this VLAN. So, he got the address from that VLAN only. But now, I've changed his VLAN. I brought him into a different VLAN. Now, 150.1.10.0 is applied to him.
And still, it is physically connected to VLAN.
Physically? No. Yeah. Physically, it's connected to here. Not VLAN. Physically, it's connected here. Here, same place. 21. Under VLAN 150. Under the interface, the VLAN is still 150. But ISE is telling the switch, change its VLAN from 150, put him into VLAN 21. So the physical 150 has no significance now. The switch is asking him to use VLAN 10. Now it won't make a difference. See, now it won't, because VLAN is being pushed. VLAN is being pushed from top. Yes, but if you remove it, that I told you the command doesn't work. Port control auto went. Port control auto. But communication between him and IS, yeah, authenticator. You have to put him into a VLAN. But any, which one? Now, which one you usually put? You push them in a guest VLAN or some VLAN which is not usually used for a lot of stuff in the beginning. And you have policies for that and stuff like that. For now, the important thing is he will not be allowed access unless he has the username and password. And if he has the username and password, he will be given a VLAN. He will always be given a VLAN, which is VLAN 10. Now, what is your IP?
10 101.
I should be able to ping. Yeah, is your firewall on? Firewall, turn it up. Yeah, because the default network depends on default gateway. If your default gateway changes, the network it names you something else. Firewall is off. Why is the ping not working then? IP address is the same. Check the firewall. All three should be off. The private, public, and domain. Private, public, and the domain. Done. Now, the access to this guy is from which VLAN? VLAN 10. But he will still have access to everybody. If you check right now, try to log off, try to turn it off, the adapter, bring it back in again. Now log in as marketing. Mark 1, password syst0123. I'll explain to you what the process is happening with the ICE. How is it actually going through?
Mark it.
Yeah, MARK1, Mark MARK1, password sysco0123 with the C capital. Success, authorization failed. It's fine, just leave it like that. Clear auth sessions. Happens the first time. No, I think you should do it again. Ah, okay. He says VLAN not found. The VLAN which was asked to push him into, because I don't think I have created it. I don't think I've created 20 and 30 yet. So VLAN 20 and VLAN. This one. Clear out sessions. Yeah, now do it again. Set it down and bring it back up again. Mark 1, Cisco 0123. Cisco 123. Now, whatever, which VLAN is assigned to him? Marketing. So, logically, where am I putting him? There'll be a problem now. Can anybody guess what that problem is? The DHCP request will not reach whom? The DHCP request is not going to reach R1. If it's not going to reach R1, you will not receive an IP address. You'll be identifying for a long time. Because it'll come out. R2 doesn't know what to do with this DHCP request, because the only one DHCP server you have is which one? That's why this topology is better. That's why I like this topology, because it makes you understand how the process works. He's authenticated. He's in the VLAN right now. He's logically connected here, the PC. But when he sends out, he's here right now, but his discover is only coming until R2. It's not going forward. How do I make him go forward? I'll go to which guy? R2. And which command? So which command do I use? Where do I use that command?
On the
to the
on the interface which is connecting towards the PC. Because that is the PC I'll receive my DHCP request on. I will basically tell R2, if you receive a DHCP request, you forward it, unicast it to
DHCP server.
I'm telling him, if you receive any DHCP request here, forward it to 151.10.1. Great. Have you received an IP?
No.
Not yet?
Yes.
You received it? So right now, his PC received an IP address. Until now it was not. It was an identifying state. Why was it an identifying state? Again, that DHCP request was not moving forward. Now, the request moved forward. He gave out an IP address to this guy. Now, it has an IP address. It's in VLAN 20. It should be able to ping R2.
Previously,
the discover was hitting R2 because it was a broadcast. R2 was cutting it. It was not letting it move forward. Now, I've changed that broadcast into a unicast towards whom? Towards R1. So the request is forwarded to R1. R1 resolves it, brings him the address. I'll have to do the same for VLAN 3 also. So I'll go to R3, the interface facing outside. Interface FA01, IP helper address is the same, 151.10.1. Why 10.1? 10.1 is the one which is facing R2 and R3. I could have done this one also, not an issue. Because they have the routes to go anywhere. But the closer one is 10.1. There is routing between R1, R2, R3. So R1 knows this network, R1 knows this network. No. No. It's directly connected. They're directly. These three are EIGRP neighbors. They're like on a switch, three people connected on the switch. They're directly connected to each other. Why would there be another? Actually, in case there will be. See, if there was another router here, help, all you needed was R2 needed a route to 150.1. Since he sends a unicast, it will automatically reach there. It's a unicast, not a broadcast. No, no, only here. Only here. Because it converts that broadcast into a unicast. Unicast, you don't need to tell R3 that to do. Because he knows there will be a routing data plane traffic for him. He'll just switch it from this side to this side. Ceph, simple. From one side to another. Normal packet. It'll be a normal packet. Yeah. With the source, and the source will be this interface. Destination will be this interface. From here, the source will be this interface. Destination will be this. Keep your attention here because I'm going to ask you a question after this. Okay. Right now, this is done. So now, do you have access to all of this? What is your IP again?
I didn't change the IP.
No, the old one, 21.
Yes, 20.100.1.
Switch one will take a little time to get there because switch one has to go through R1, then R1 has to go to R2, R2 has to go all over the place. I don't think switch one can reach it. Why? Check out the routing table on switch one. It's not a layer 3 switch right now. IP? IP routing. IP routing still won't be able to go. Why? Because I have to give him a default gate. Pointing towards whom? 7.1, R1. R1 is the default gateway, right? Now I should be able to ping home. 20.101, right? Check out what your default gateway is.
I don't have a default.
You don't have a default gateway? 20.2, right? Which is R2. 20.2, great. 20.101, which is you. Why am I not able to ping you again? No? You should, yeah. 20.2. Try pinging 20.2. Hello?
I can reach you.
You can reach? Firewall. Hello? Yeah? Haanji. Haan, Piyush, bolo. Kahan ho tum? There you go. This is the firewall on the PC. So 20.1, switch one can also ping. Clear? It's just VLAN assignment. Try it with the third one. Marketing.
Yeah.
The charger. Use this one. Try with marketing. Mark 1 and Cisco 1, 2, 3. Same.
Mark 1 is Mark 1.
Mark 1.
Now is Mark 1.
Now is Mark 1. So IT 1.
Okay.
IT 1 is Cisco 1, 2, 3 with a C capital. The password is the same. Yeah. So I'll show you. Show you all of that. IT 1, Cisco 1, 2, 3 for the C capital. Done. VLAN 30 has been assigned. What IP should be given to him? 30.something. Now, no talking. What I want you to see is this. Show auth sessions. Shows you where your port control auto is running, which ports is it running on, what is the MAC address of the device that is there connected to the port, what method did I use to authenticate him, .1x. It's data, there's two, data and voice. Voice is IP phones. And authorization was what? Successful. There's a session ID also here for this session. Authorization for this guy was successful. To look at it in more details, show run, show auth sessions, you specify the interface you want to look at. So gives you the full details of it. You have, MAC address was this guy. IP address is unknown, but the username that came in was what? His status is authorization successful. Data, leave this for now. We'll see this one at a time. Who authorized this guy and authorization, authentication server? What VLAN was given to him? VLAN 30 was given to him, right? And some other things here. Show VLAN brief. We'll show you which VLAN he is into right now, which is 30. And right now, the problem though is this. I have put him into different VLANs. I have given them different IP addresses. I can apply restrictions on, say, for example, IAC. I'll tell them only 151.7.0 should be able to access you. Right? Or I could have, say, a firewall in front of the IAC and protect everybody else from coming in except for R1. Because now, the difference between all of them is their IP addresses. Sales will always be 10, marketing will always be 20, IT will always have the IP address of 30. So I know the difference between them based on their IP addresses. That's one way of authorizing. You have divided them into IP addresses, you can apply policies on different, whatever devices, other devices you have, you can apply it on those devices and make it work. Let's see the process of how it's happening right now, how everything is happening between the physical and logical. Because that, I think, is very important. TestPC comes in here. TestPC comes in. The switch is .1x enabled. Connected to whom? IAC. The switch asks him for what? Username, password. TestPC replies with the username and password. This whole process is EAPOL. Switch takes this, takes it to whom? IAC. Check out what happens on ISC with the same username and password. Username is what? Sales, for example. Sales falls under which group?
Group sales.
It falls under group sales.
So first thing he does is authentication. The first thing that he does is authenticate the guy. He sees he sales one and password is correct, so he authenticates the guy. Based on these protocols, he checks if the protocol is there, he authenticates him and lets him come in, wired MAB or wireless or wired.NX, right? Once he's authenticated, then he's supposed to check this, what? These rules. Because the switch is not only asking for authentication, he's only also asking for authorization of the guy. He checks authorization. He sees, okay, sales, I have a rule already. If it's sales and a wired.NX switch matches, I'm supposed to give him sales result. What is sales result? Check what it is. Sales result says, give him VLAN 10. So ICE directs whom? ICE replies and directs the switch, not the username or password. Directs the switch and tell him, listen, auth success plus VLAN 10. This port is put into VLAN 10. Huh. Well, who did that? Overheat ho gaya project. It'll take time. Okay, so what I was talking about is what the IESE is going to reply when he replies back is not only authorized but also give him a VLAN 10. He tells it to whom? His client. IESE's client is only switch. So switch allows him access, puts him into VLAN 10, and then he receives his IP or DHCP or whichever address, whichever way he does, based on which VLAN he's putting. Okay? That is physical. Logically, I've told you. Logically, he's put wherever you want him to be, based on the VLAN. Good? Good with VLANs? The only problem is right now, Stephen can still be able to access IS. Try. If he goes to the browser and types 151.7.20, he should still be able to open the page of IS. Okay? Which is a problem. Can you? The only thing is, I have put them into VLANs. I have differentiated between them using their IP addresses now. The only problem is I have not controlled access. I told you I could control access based on IP addresses now. I can see it in your glasses. I could control access based on IP addresses. Now I could have firewall, I could have policies here, wherever on the routers, maybe this router incoming interface, I'll say do not allow access from 151.20 to ICE, or here I could say do not allow it from 30 to ICE, or whatever. I could do it on R1, this interface, right? Because everybody is coming through this interface. I can do that, or I can actually do it on the switch with something known as DACL, downloadable ACL. When the ICE is telling him put him into VLAN 10, he can also actually push down an ACL. That ACL is applied on that port right here, per user. It's called per user ACL. It's applied on that port, whichever ACL you want him to. So you're cutting off the traffic right at the source before coming into the network. You're cutting him off. Here, it would not have been efficient because the traffic would still cross these two routers. You're stopping him here before even reaching R2. You're stopping it at the switch, the DACL. Now, you have to be very careful with DACLs. Keep this in mind, right? The other thing is, I showed you this one command. Show auth sessions interface FA021. What do you see here? IP address is unknown. The switch doesn't know what the IP is. Who knows? The PC got an IP from R1. The switch was just in the middle. When you remember when you enable DHCP snooping? The switch keeps track of the DHCP packets which are going through, and then he creates a table out of it. So he knows what IP address is given to what device. DHCP binding table is. DHCP snooping binding. Now, or you can use the command source binding, IP source binding. Now, I want him to do the same. I want switch one to know what IP address is on that side. To do that, I will not enable DHCP snooping. I'll use something known as IP device. What IP device tracking does is it sends out probes. Show IP device tracking on. It sends out probes on dynamic interfaces. It will send out probes to check what the IP is on the other side. Whichever guy receives an IP address from a DHCP server, what this guy does, IP device tracking, is he sends out probes to that link every 30 seconds to receive what the IP on the other side has received, what is the MAC address, what is the interface, which VLAN does he belong to. What do you get here? 30.101 is this PC right here. He's got the MAC address of this guy and he's got VLAN of this, plus this interface. He's connected to the switch using this interface. Now check this. Show authentication sessions interface FA021. The DHCP ones, the ones which received IP using DHCP. Username was IT1, the password is not given here, but the IP address which is given to that guy is right here, 151.30.1. Now if he goes to marketing, he'll be given a different one, 20. whatever. If he's given IT, he'll be given something else. IT is this, obviously, sales will be 10. This is something else. This is something else. This is extra authenticated security, encrypted security. You don't need to worry about that now. There's a lot of things here. Single host, all of these with time. Okay? Now, we have done this VLAN 30. I want to be able to control this device right when he comes in. I don't want him, his policies to be somewhere else. I want that DACL to be downloaded. For DACL to download on the switch, you have to give in one command. It's called radius server VSA send authentication. Vendor specific. Why you do need this is whenever the DACL is pushed down to the switch is not authorized to use it. Because it's something drastic, a big change is happening now. You're actually giving him an ACL and asking him to install that ACL where on the port?
Layer 2.
On layer 2. No, he'll do it on layer 3. He'll do it on layer 3. Once he receives that IP address, then he'll be allowed the access. But the access list will be applied to that port, right? The access list will be applied to that port. The port is layer 2.
The switch work in layer 2.
The port is layer 2. And it's per user basis. But the access list are IP address, which is layer
3.
Which is layer 3. For the switch to do that, for the switch to have the capability to actually install that kind of an ACL, he needs to send information back to the radio server. He needs to be able to communicate to the radio server at that time, the moment he's installing the DSL. That's why this command is important.
VSA
vendor specific attribute. It doesn't only work with Cisco, with other devices, with other vendors, because it's ICE, right? It's radius. It's a radius server. So it doesn't really have to be just Cisco. It can work with a lot of other devices. But the DACL needs to be downloaded on each one of them. Now, whichever is your layer 3 switch, whichever layer 3 switch you configure to go along with this, that would require this command. Again, each vendor will have their own specific command because the code is going to be different. just like an acknowledgement that I've installed that DACL. But if he's not able to do that, he will not be able to install that DACL. So be careful. If your VLAN assignment is working and your DACL is not working, that means you're missing this command. You're missing this command. Plus, device tracking is also important. IP device tracking is also important. Why?
For the access list.
For the access list. These two commands. Why is it important? Because access list is layer 3. You need the address of the other guy. He needs to be able to see the other guy from layer 3's perspective, not layers 2, layer 2 perspective. For him, for the switch to see the other guy from layer 3 perspective, he needs device tracking. And how? Now he can see the guy from layer 3 perspective here, as well as here. Earlier he didn't have this. All he knew was MAC address. So he was seeing it as a layer 2 device. Now he sees it as a layer 3 device. The ACL which you are applying is layer 3. So two commands for DACL. Where's my notepad today? This was .1x. 1.2 that I'm going to do is VLAN assignment. What did I do? Now here, AAA authorization network default group, that's all. 1.3 is what? The ACL assignment. I need to do IP device tracking and radius server VSA send authentication. Okay, done. Now let's go back to, now this is the easy step. Go back to our authorization profiles. Sorry, our authentic policy results. We have something called downloadable ACLs. You create the ACL separately, you install them separately. Create the ACL separately, you install them separately. First, I'll create it for all three of them. The first one I'll create is for sales ACL. Now, this has to be very, very, very specific. If you even press enter or if you miss a space, this is not going to work. This ACL has to be specific. No extra spaces. Okay? Now, I'm going to tell him, all right, do this one thing. Deny IP from any to host. The source will be any because I don't know what this source he's going to get. The guy is going to get any IP address, right? Going to host. Yeah. If I use?
Sales.
I know the range. I know the range that 151.10.0/24. But any is also fine. Permit IP any. No enter, do not press an enter. Right? Deny IP any. Deny access to 151.27.20. Allow everything else. Done? Another one I'll create is mark_ACL. DACL deny ICMP from any to host 151.7.20. Permit IP, any. This is just an example now. This is the flexibility. I mean, you can actually apply whatever ACL you want. Whichever access you want to block, whichever access you want to permit, you can do that. For IT, I'll allow him everything. By default, there are two created already for you. One is deny all traffic, the other one is permit all traffic. Let's check what's inside them. Deny IP any, and permit will be permit IP any. How do I apply these ACLs? I'll go back to the same profiles which I had before. Sales profile, sales result was only giving VLAN until now. Now he'll not only just give VLANs, he'll also give out
Which ACL?
Sales
ACL. Done? Then, sales, marketing will give out which ACL? Marketing ACL. And IT, now you can either give the IT ACL or you could just say permit all traffic. Both are the same. Both say permit IP and EAT. But since I've created it specifically for him, do I need to do anything else on IAC? No, because the result has already been put in the rule. I'm already giving this result to IT. I'm already giving this mark to marketing. I just edited this to not only give out VLAN 10, but also to give out dynamic ACLs. Downloadable ACLs. Downloadable ACLs. Good? Let's try. Now, do it again. Clear auth sessions. If you want to clear it only on one interface, you say interface 021. Or you can do it for all authentication success will be cleared. Or you can do it for both. Starting out one X.
You
know your security guard, but please don't
do that. No, just
another
firewall.
It comes back in again.
Done?
Yes. Succeeded. VLAN 10 has been assigned.
Yes.
Authorization has been succeeded. But he has not received a DACL. Oh yeah, he has. Check this out. Sales_ACL has been assigned. Until now, only VLAN 10 was assigned. Now, sales_ACL has been assigned. If you use show access list command, check this. This is the ACL which is downloaded from ISC to the switch. From ISC, and it's what? Per user basis. Where is it applied? To port 21. And what does it say? It says deny IP any to host. Yes. Can you ping 151.27.20? Which are default? This is there by default. The moment you enable this, it's there by default. Why? It is applied to each port before authentication. Before authentication, why? It allows access to boot PS, which is your DHCP. And it allows access to, again, boot PC has two or three ports. What it does is, check this out, whenever you come in, whenever you log into that port, you're authenticated successfully. Between authenticated successfully and between authorization successful, you're giving this ACL. Which one? Which only permits one thing. What is that? DHCP. Why? Because he wants you to first receive an IP address. After you receive an IP address, this ACL is applied. Why this? Because he doesn't want you to do anything else in the network except for DHCP. Unless you receive an ACL. The moment you receive that ACL, the moment you receive that IP address, then I will push the real ACL which is meant for you to your port. Now you should be able to ping everybody except for ICE. Right? 151.7.1, you should be able to ping. 7.15, you should be able to ping. 7.16, you should be able to ping. Should not be able to ping 20 because I'm blocking 20. Let's check from this end. Operations, authentication. Check this out. Sales guy came in, his MAC address was this, came in using this interface. The authorization profile which I gave him is sales result.
The group that he belongs to on ISE is sales. Posture not applicable. It will not be applicable because we have not done it. Authentication is succeeded. But above this, you'll see something else. ACS, sales ACL. And in the end, here you'll see DACL downloaded successfully, succeeded. Earlier, you never saw DACL download, right?
No.
Earlier, it was just mark 1, coming into switch 1, allowed, capable, I'll give him mark result, and that's it. No ACLs. With ACLs, you have two extra, one extra line on top, because he has to do it separately. Download that ACL onto this one. Try with IT now. IT1 and Cisco 123 with the CCAP. Success, VLAN assigned, authorization succeeded, short sessions interface F021. Another ACL has been downloaded, but this one is called what? IT ACL. And what does this ACL say? Permit IP. Now you should be able to ping and open. IT people are allowed because they are the ones who manage my IAC. So I allow them full access. Others are not allowed access to IAC. It's not only IAC again. This is just a template. These ACLs are just a template. Now, whichever kind of network you have, whichever type of access you want to block, you can do it based on these ACLs. Just download it on that code. The best part is if they are added to that code. Logically, accesses are added to that code. So you don't have to worry about anything else because you'll be stopping the guy at the code. Now say one PC, a guy can come in, he can be a sales guy, a guy can come in, he can be an IT guy, a guy can come in, he can be whatever. It's not linked to the port is automatic. It can either be VLAN 20, 30, 10, whichever you want it to be. It can have ACL, IT ACL or sales ACL or the other kinds of ACL. The same port. Right? Clear? Any questions? IP phone does not have a username and password. We authenticate them based on MAC addresses. That is MAB, MAC address bypass. You have a way of doing username and password also, but mostly we use it using MAB because they're not capable of attacking you, so you don't need much security with them. MAC address is fine. Should be able to authenticate them based on that.
For the access list to the DACP. Is pre-configured by default. By
the moment you enable DACL policies, the moment you enable that, he uses that ACL automatically. He will be there on the switch always because he'll be using it always. Whenever a new guy comes in, before he gets the original ACL, he's given this ACL so that he doesn't do anything malicious until that time, until he gets an IP address. That's why only DHCP is allowed. This will be applied to that code the moment he authenticates successfully, until he gets an IP address.
I have another question, but I think it's not sense, but I ask you.
That's fine, I like nonsensical questions.
It means, is imagine the topology is my traffic between the switch 1 to the ICE through the ASA.
Okay.
So logically, yeah. I need to know this specific
ACLs. To allow, if there's an ACL in the front, you don't really need all of this. You only need to know which IP address is going to go where.
Yes, you can see that.
Source any protocol. And destination any. What you're saying is, see, there's an ASA in the middle, right?
Yes.
There's an ASA between ISE. This is the ASA. This is the switch. And this is your ISE. Say this is inside, this is outside. So to come from this to this, you'll have to apply an ACL first. First of all, you'll enable UDP 18. First of all, UDP 1812. Why? Because the relationship between the switch and the ICE will be set up that way. The other one is, yeah, radius. The other one is, now this guy will come in. He'll have an IP. He won't have an IP. Okay, without the IP. He comes in. Yeah, that's okay. He comes in, he communicates to whom? Only the switch? The switch communicates to whom? ICE? Which protocol? So whatever he's doing with him does not matter. As long as switch and ICE have that radius capability, he will take that information from this guy, take it to ICE. You don't need to enable anything on the SA. Just that one UDP 1813, 1812. If you're using accounting, then 1813. But mostly for authorization and authentication, you only use 1813. So it doesn't matter if he has 10 ACLs or if he has 10 things to authenticate with. The only one protocol that the switch and the ICE will use is radius.
Yes.
Okay. Nothing much, yeah. Just same copy, this configuration, paste it on the other port. Done. Which config? The switch main config is done already. The global config is done. Only this config you need to copy from here, paste it on the other. These four commands. Three commands. For .1x, it's only three commands. Two. The others are just access and old commands which you know already. Only two commands you need. Port control auto, enable it for authentication and based on automatic .1x and authenticator. .1x PAE authenticator. Done? Questions?
Where do we use WebAuth?
WebAuth is something else. WebAuth is for users who do not have a username and password. It's not for salespeople, not for IT people, because they have a username and password already. It's for people who just come into your network. Who just come into your network. They come into your network. Right? And you don't have any VLAN to provide them. You don't provide them any VLAN. So what you do is, you put them into VLAN 150, but you also put an ACL on top of them, which will deny every access to them, except for which service? DHCP. So that receive an IP address. You give them an IP address. You give them an IP address. Then, for them to log in, because they are in VLAN 150, you want to give them access. You give them login access through a portal, web portal. Their internet will be working, but they will not be able to surf the internet. Whenever they try to go anywhere, they'll be given with that portal. And they'll be asked to put in a username and password. So if you don't want to use .1x, if you don't have .1x capabilities on the device, WebAuth will show you the same username and password page, but through a web page. The moment you try to go to the internet, you get that web page. You might have seen it in hotels, a lot of hotels, airports.
Yes.
You try to log in, you see the internet is open, you click, log in. Try to open something, you get that page. First log in, then go forward. That's called WebAuth. There's different ways of doing it. Local WebAuth, centralized WebAuth. Local is very cheap way of doing it, not a lot of people do it. Centralized is the one which is on. We'll do both. We'll do centralized as well as local, both of them. Yeah? Which ones? You don't use it, yeah. You won't use it on the core switches, obviously. No, on the access switches. The one which connect up to the PCs. The one which connect up to the final devices. The access layer. If there are thousands, see. It's usually, say for example, there'll be a room for guests to come in. Whenever guests come into your company, you put them in a room. For them. For salespeople, this switch will have all sales VLAN. All of the salespeople sit in one room. So on that switch, all the ports will be .1x enabled. And they'll have to log in using username and password. Someone is asking a question. Okay. Another switch, it cannot be connected to another switch. It has to be an access port. It's connected to a PC. Okay. To those switches uses access. They will be authorized. Because that's a layer 2 switch, so it's fine for them. Layer 2 to layer 3. Can do that. Yeah, but I don't think this is not usually what's done. Usually, .1x is not used for wired authentications. Wired is normal. You just have wired for sales. Sales people log in and use it. Why we use .1x mostly is wireless authentication. Because wireless, the only security you have is a password. And if you have a password, you don't know which VLAN you're going to be put into. You want to do the same capabilities to what? To the wireless devices also. Wired gives you the concept. You'll move it along to the WLC. You've done WLC before, right? You'll move it along to the WLC, on the WLC. Same thing, one which you did here. Same thing on the WLC will give you full control of the network. At that time, the guy is just here, opens his phone, checks the network, only one SSID. There'll be only one SSID. But if you log in using sales username and password, you'll be put into VLAN 30. If you log in using VLAN 10. If you log in using IT, you'll be put into VLAN 10. Your ACL will be different. Your other stuff will be different. Okay? The concept will remain the same. What you're saying is in companies, right? You keep it as port control auto, maybe sometimes when you need it. Right? Usually you don't do it like that. Usually just keep it in VLANs, right? Just keep ports in different VLANs. But the capability is on the switch to do something like that. Production environment, you use what? Wireless. .1x is very famous for wireless. Okay? Clear? That would be all for today. .1x. We'll move forward with MAB. We'll do MAB on wired. Plus, we'll also start .1x on wireless. We'll do that on Monday.